Hey everybody, welcome back to the channel. If you're new here, please don't forget to hit the subscribe button so you can catch more videos like this as I do post them. Also, please check out the description section below where I do put more information, and there might also potentially be some links in there, so check it out. If you have any questions, put that stuff in the comments and I'll try to get back to you. Let's get started. This is going to be a review of the Definitive Technology SR9080 bipolar surround speaker. Got the manual here, so I'm going to first start off with the specifications before getting into the story that I have about these. It's pretty interesting. So the overall frequency response is 40 hertz to 30 kilohertz, which is actually really good for a speaker this size. The sensitivity is 92 decibels, which is also really good because they're going to play louder. The impedance, the nominal impedance, is 8 ohms, and the recommended amplifier power, they're saying, is 20 to 200 watts. Let's see. So it has two base mid-range drivers. There's one on each side. And those are 4.5-inch drivers. Then there's two tweeters, and it's 1-inch. So there's your tweeters. The manual is pretty, it's pretty basic. It's just these two pages. So there's not too much to it. It gives you a little bit of a basic about positioning the speakers and just basic troubleshooting stuff and the warranty on it. Before I get into my notes, I do want to show the speaker. So the speaker on each side, one side has a port, okay? So the port here, and there's no port here. And you could see that it's upside down. Now, I don't have the grills on, as you could see. I took the grills off. So each speaker is gonna have one port on the same side. On the back, we have one set of the binding posts, okay? And it's the typical Definitive quality posts. And I say that because they feel good, you know? I like them, they feel good. They also stop, they don't go flying off when I do this. See, they stop, which is nice. Definitive definitely makes them the best binding posts that I've used in a speaker. They're just excellent. And also it has this keyhole slot for mounting it. You can see it on the back. I put this piece of felt over here because I have them standing on top of a bookshelf, and this is so that it could just touch the wall without scraping the wall. So that's just a piece of that, those cheap felt things that I love so much. So I have an interesting story about this speaker. It was kind of like a saga for me, to be honest. It didn't go like how I thought it would. And to be honest, it's one of those times in life where I'm kind of kicking myself for not doing what I would usually do. And you know how in life you might have certain rules that you make for yourself and you say, well, you know, do this first, always do this or do that. Well, I didn't do what I should have done first, but I do want to tell the story. When I first connected these speakers, I connected them to the surround back speakers. So I have a 9.1, the 7.1 is the base of it. So it's 7.1 plus two front height speakers. And that's important because these are the surround back, so they were in the back of me behind the couch, and then I had my two surround speakers off to the left and to the right. I was listening to these speakers, and the speakers sounded like each one of them had a different sound, like somewhat out of phase as well, and they just didn't sound like two speakers that were the same speaker, that they were equals. I noticed that when I was using the leveling tone on the receiver to, you know, set the volume, and that's that type of a pink noise type of sound that the receiver, you know, puts out to test each speaker. So when I am listening to it, of course, I'm sitting like this and the speakers are behind me. So to make it a little bit more exact, you know, one would be like here, one would be here. Of course, they're further apart. You know, I'm sitting here. And so I'm listening to them with the test tone and I'm like, it just, they sound different. They, you know, and I thought maybe I was just hearing things. And then I noticed that one of them, I thought maybe one of them was potentially out of phase. So I contacted Definitive Tech, and I sent them an email through their tech support, and I asked them if maybe these speakers are a dipole, because listening to it, it sounded more like a dipole. And if you want to know what a dipole is, check out the video I have, which is about monopoles, bipoles, and dipoles. But with a dipole, you know, one of them, one of the sides is out of phase. So Definitive Tech said, no, they are a true bipole or bipolar speaker. So I'm thinking, you know, it doesn't sound like it to me. Maybe something's wrong with the internals. Maybe something was wired wrong, you know, the positive and negative is screwed up. I don't know. I thought maybe something was wrong. I'm having a lot of difficulty with hearing the surround backs during movies. And I was playing these for about 3 months. I turned up the volume on them louder than they really should be. Now, usually with this type of a speaker, I find that turning up the volume when setting the level for each of them, they usually do have to be a little bit higher, in my opinion, for them to produce the same type of sound as like a monopole would. So like if I was going to set the monopole to maybe, let's say, a 3, I would maybe be setting these to a 4.5 or a 5 on the volume. That's just been my experience with a bipole surround speaker. So with these, I was, you know, increasing the volume, trying to, you know, make sure that I hear the sound, and I'm just not hearing the sound right. Again, the sounds sounded like it was out of phase. Also, didn't sound clear, like the mid-range just was not clear on these. So what I did was I hooked them up to play music, which is what I should have done from the start. So let me back up. I should have from the start, like I do with every speaker, regardless of if I'm using it for surround or the front or whatever, hook them up to the main speakers and just play music. So I hooked them up to the main speakers and I put on Johnny Cash, his last CD before he passed away, the one that has Hurt on it and When the Man Comes Around. Anyway, it's his voice and, you know, acoustic guitar for, you know, most of it. Most of the CD is that. Anyway, When the Man Comes Around sounded horribly atrocious. And, you know, as an example, I mean, I have Definitive speakers. This is a Definitive speaker, and Man Comes Around sounds very different on this than these did. The tower speakers I have, the other tower speakers I have. So When the Man Comes Around, it sounded so dull. It sounded so muffled and like muddy sound, like there was no mid-range. I'm listening to it, and because like this is also Definitive, right? I mean, look at the tweeter, even looks almost the same. You look at the tweeter. It looks like the same tweeter. And I think the frequency response is actually the same. I think this one's also like 30 kilohertz or something like that on the tweeter. So, but you know, the mid-range is different. This one has this little mushroom thing, that waveguard or whatever they call it. Anyway, not to get too sidetracked, but you know, the clarity should have been here, right? But the clarity just wasn't. So I decided that, you know, I'm going to try to break them in before I contact the manufacturer again and say, you know, these things are defective, or I just dump them in the trash. So what I did was, I was playing music, and I was playing music for hours. I even put on some earplugs so I could play them louder than I would normally play music and not be irritated by it throughout the house, or, you know, potentially affect my hearing. So I'm playing these with the volume very clean, but you know, a little bit louder than I would, so that it's moving these drivers. And I'm also feeling, you know, the air coming out of the port. This is the funny part. These speakers needed to be broken in. And it took about 6 hours of me playing music on top of the 3 months that I used them as surround speakers, where you figure an hour to 2 hours every night. I'm watching maybe half a movie or a whole movie. And it just needed some real, real play time. After that, speakers sound great. But, you know, what's the problem with the phasing? Why does it sound out of phase? And I'm gonna explain this in very simple terms. It's the port. Here's the D for definitive. The D is down here. Okay, here's the D. Okay, here's the port. Here's the D. Here's the port. These don't come in a left or right speaker. They just come like this. So the port is on one side. So when you're listening to this like this, let's say, as surround speakers, right, surround back, one side has this port. This port makes this speaker sound different. And it made me go crazy trying to like figure it out. Because of course, you know, the drivers are upside down. Like here, the tweeter's on the bottom. The tweeter's on the bottom with this one, okay? And the tweeter's more on the top. So they're flipped, but the port. So if I'm sitting here watching the movie, the port is sending a different sound at me than the side without the port. So what's the solution? The solution would be plug the port or do exactly what I did. Get those little felt things that I love, put it on, and now this speaker is upside down. So now we have two sides with no port, right? So again, it's behind me, I'm listening. The sound is coming this way. It's uniform. The sound that's going this way has the port, and it's going towards the walls. Again, it's uniform. Or my preference was this. Put this one here and put this one here. So the port is here, okay, on the bottom, because the speaker is upside down. The port is up top here. So at least when I'm sitting and I'm listening and I'm getting the sound from here and I'm getting the sound from here, I'm getting the tweeter, the woofer, and the port. And I'm getting the port, the tweeter, and the woofer, or the mid-bass driver woofer thing. So that's the catch. And the port was making it, to me, sound like one of them was out of phase. So that's basically the long, short version of my saga with these speakers. The other speaker that they sell, which is the SR9040, it's smaller and it doesn't have any port, but the woofer, let's see, the frequency response, the lowest, it says 50 hertz, and the mid-bass woofer is 3.5 inches instead of 4.5 inches. You know, that might be something to consider. It's cheaper, it has no port. You know, I personally like the sound of this speaker. I don't think I would want the smaller version. By flipping one upside down, that solves the problem, because again, here's the port, here's the ported side. The sound is coming this way. That's the bulk of the sound coming towards my ears when I'm watching movies. And the side without the port is going off this way. Either way, it's now uniform. You know, these speakers needed a left and right. They needed a pair. Or the port should have been like here. You know, each of these speakers should have had the port like right in the front, bottom. Something like that, that would make it sound nice and uniform instead of off to the side. I'm sure that there's reasons why it's like that. You know, I'm not the company. Again, I'm not a sound engineer. But to me, to my ears, it doesn't make sense. With that said, if you're going to purchase these, consider the port issue. So if you're going to mount these on your back wall, you want to hang these, you know, you can't flip one upside down and mount it. So in that situation, this one would then be like this. So you'd be back here where there's a port and then there's no port. You know, maybe in that situation, just plug the ports and be done with it. But, okay, it does sound fuller with the port open. You can hear the additional bass. You could hear the additional fullness of it, you know, with the port unplugged. Because I thought about like putting a piece of duct tape over it, or you know, a piece of a sponge. I got these sponge filters that I have for the aquarium, and have these extra sponge filters that haven't been used, and I could have just squeezed one and just popped it in the hole and, you know, been done with it. Just consider that if you are going to purchase these, if you're going to put them on top of a bookshelf like the way I did, then, you know, maybe flipping it upside down might be the way to go. Again, just pick up some of these cheap felt pads or a rubber version, you know, whatever appeals to you, and, you know, it'll sound great. Now, as for the sound quality of these, after breaking them in, they sound really good. I mean, it sounds like, you know, one of their speakers. Definitive makes speakers that sound nice. They you know, they have overall good sound quality. They're not overly bright. They actually, they sound really good with music. Two of these and a sub, the system would be golden. Using these as, you know, a front left and a front right plus a subwoofer, it would sound great. I enjoyed listening to these with music when I had it hooked up, trying to break it in. I do want to mention one more thing, is that Definitive recommends with these speakers for the 9080 to set the crossover at 80 hertz when connecting it to the receiver, or, you know, or connecting it to a subwoofer. So the speaker setup when connecting it to the amplifier should be to set the speaker to 80 hertz on the crossover and set the speaker to small. For the 9040, the smaller model of this, they say to set the crossover to 100 hertz. So just keep that in mind. So these speakers would be great as a cheaper alternative to get the type of Definitive sound when using them as a front speaker along with a sub. Because of course they do need a sub because they are so small. But without the sub on their own, when I was playing them with music, I enjoyed it overall. I mean, I thought that the sound was nice. The sound was the typical quality that I'm used to from a Definitive. I enjoy them now as surround speakers. They're excellent. They really fill out the back soundstage, especially when watching movies where there's a lot of, you know, swooshing flying around, or like a lot of explosions coming from the rear. It really makes the rear soundstage sound nice and wide. Very, very excellent. I watched Rain of Fire with these, which is a movie about dragons. It's a dragon apocalypse. It's like one of my favorite movies. And the dragons on that soundtrack, they just, when they fly overhead and they swoosh, it's so powerful sounding. Anyway, having these hooked up to the surround backs and have them in line with a subwoofer that's like 300 watt sub, I mean, it's just, woof, the sound was just fantastic, mind-blowing. Anything else that I'm watching where the surround backs are being used heavily, they sound fantastic. Nice wide soundstage. So a pair of these speakers really could be used in multiple ways. So let's just say if you're on a budget, you could start off with these as the main left, the main left and the main right speaker, to hook it up to a receiver along with a sub, and then eventually move these off to the rear if you decide to purchase a tower speaker, to replace them. Overall, the treble on these things sounds really good. It's not too bright. It's not too harsh. I'm using these for movies now, but when I did have it hooked up for music, I really enjoyed them. The mid-range was good. The voices were coming through nicely. And the bass for a speaker this small, the bass does sound good. I was pretty impressed. The port, though, has to stay open for you to get that lower bass sound. And again, you know, the port, each port would have to be, you know, facing the listener. So however you'd want to position them, the port side would have to be facing. So if you're going to use these for the front speakers with music and you wanted to do some kind of a you know, strange type of angle thing, you know, you really could. You can pick these up on sale, and I believe a pair of them would be like $500 on sale. Off sale might be like $700, because I think that they sell for $350 each normally, but you could catch them for, you know, $250 a piece. So just keep that in mind. Picking them up at $250 each, $500 for the pair, I think it's a no-brainer, as long as, of course, you know, you have the location where you could set them up and potentially either plug the port or flip it upside down, or maybe it just don't bother you at all. And, you know, one side's ported, one side's not. And, you know, it's not ruining your listening enjoyment. So just, you know, keep that in mind. If these speakers were used on the right and left sides pointing in, again, you know, the port in that situation would be like this, you know, because this would really be, here's the D for definitive, here's the D for definitive. So you would see, you know, you'd have one, it would be like this, so the D for definitive. So you'd see, you'd have, here's your port, here's your no port, and here's your ported side. So that's if they were used like this and they were pointing in on the sides. Again, unless if it was, you know, flipped upside down like that, then everything's uniform. It's going to sound better. I appreciate you staying tuned and watching this video. If you have any questions or comments, please post them below.